is an Unspoiled Network podcast.
This is Unspoiled, covering the Dresden Files, Book 3, Grave Peril. In these chapters, Harry's got a new friend, and he works for the big guy upstairs. I mean that in so many different senses. Welcome to Unspoiled. I'm a rolling thunder, power and rain. I'm coming on like a hurricane. My lightning's flashing across the sky. You're only young, but you're gonna die. I won't take no prisoners, won't spare no lives. Nobody's putting up a fight. I got my bill, I'm gonna take you to hell. I'm gonna get you, save, get you, a hell's bells. All right. Welcome to the show.
I was just going to say, I feel like we should make sure that we are clear about the premise of the show.
Yeah, I was about to say, I was like, welcome to the show. This is Unspoiled, where at least one co-host does not know what the fuck is going on. That's going to be my new intro every week to every show.
Because clearly it's necessary.
Guys, for those of you who are not patrons, I posted a screenshot of a hilarious review that we got for Hannibal, in which they were very upset because I didn't know anything about the character Hannibal or the show.
You hadn't done any research at all.
They clearly just did not understand what Unspoiled is. They were mad about it.
Yeah, they really appreciated the spoiled co-host and the time he took to learn about the show.
Yeah, they left a 1-star review and they were like, that 1-star is for Alan. And I was like, well, shit. All right, Jesus. So yeah, I'm going to, you know, go out of my way every episode to be like, hey guys, Rashawn doesn't know shit about shit. Don't mess it up.
Yeah. Please don't write in that you're disappointed that I don't know shit about shit.
How fucked up would it be if somebody was like, I'm so disappointed that Rashawn didn't know that Harry Dresden dies in book 7 and they just like blurted some fucking crazy spoiler out.
See, this is, but you know what? I don't look at the reviews, so.
That's true.
I keep trying to get an iTunes account so I can leave reviews.
And you keep trying? Does it not work?
It just is a pain in the dick. I'm sorry.
It's a pain in the dick.
I've been trying to do it for a couple of years now, and you got to download the thing, and then And I get so aggravated. Last week I tried it and I was like, well, let me try it from the desktop because maybe the mobile thing isn't working for me. And it's, you know, and it still didn't work. Like I downloaded it and then it acted like I didn't and I couldn't find it. And I just get annoyed.
I can hear it in your voice.
Yeah, right. You can hear how mad I am. Because I have been trying to get an iTunes account since we started recording together.
Damn.
Yeah.
That's really weird. I might just like do that for you.
I don't know. And now, you know, it's not just iTunes anymore. Now it's like Apple Music.
Oh, that's true.
Which is a whole other pain in the ass.
Yeah. And
it just, you guys just do reviews in my name. I'll just co-sign it. You just go ahead.
You know, people will do that too. And they're going to say some weird shit.
All right. Yeah, guys, don't do that.
Well, while we're on that note, I'm going to go ahead and do the reviews at the beginning of the episode, like I've been saying I was going to do and haven't been doing. Oh. So, yeah, welcome to new patrons. I'm really excited, actually, because I finished this advertising jaunt today that I made, which those of you who are not patrons will hear later on in the episode. And there'll be variations of it from here on out. But, you know, just putting together some theme songs from the various shows and movies that I've covered for patrons. And those of you who are new patrons get access to all of these things. And I'm not sure that all of you even know they exist. So, today we have Iha Again, Molly Murray, Vanessa Marino, Ariel Elena Feek, Emily Daniel, Sarah Sanders, Simone Solar, Andrew Nguyen, Amy Lucas, Katie Hansen. What's up, guys? Welcome to all of you wonderful people. Do you know what I'm really happy about? Is that I am 3 patrons away from reaching my next goal, which is watching Godfather, the trilogy.
Ooh. And I can't talk you into just doing the first 2 movies.
Would you really want me, like, if the consensus with everyone is that they would rather I didn't, I won't.
Oh, but... I'm just talking shit. I still haven't seen the 3rd movie.
Oh, you haven't? So it's just, no. Oh, okay. I mean, I have heard that it's not worth seeing, to be honest. Yes, but I feel like I'm a completionist. Like, I kind of have to for my own sanity. But I don't know if people want to hear me talk about it. So maybe I'll just watch the first 2, talk about those, and then I'll watch the 3rd one and just be angry all alone. I mean, that's possible, right? You're just keeping your shit to yourself. We have a 2 new reviews, 3 new reviews. I lied. Sketcher Salt from the United States, 5 stars, says, excited to dig in. The entirety of my roommates, including my boyfriend, have raved about the Dresden Files, and I finally have a reason to listen. I've had the privilege of listening to Natasha and Rashawn's wonderful discussion and banter through the Unspoiled Harry Potter podcast, and I'm delighted to actually be on the unspoiled side of the podcast this time around. Great job, guys, and thanks for the great content. Nerd named Ray from the United States. Oh, you know what? This one's an older one, actually. The new one is I Wish Mister Was My Cat by Apete07 from the United States. I'm new to the Dresden Files. I eagerly devoured all the books in just a few weeks, so listening to Natasha and Rashawn carefully dissect the books has been so much fun. A wonderful way to feed my newest addiction. Natasha and Rashawn have wonderful chemistry, and after listening to Harry Potter, I can't wait for Rashawn to blurt out the next lobster prongs. Must listen. Mm-hmm. Yay! Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
So... what did you think of the start of this book? Because it's a very different vibe than it's been before.
It just hits the fucking ground running.
Mm-hmm.
And I really loved it. I loved that it started that way. Also, this new character who, in my mind, looks like a Knight of the Templar.
That's fair.
I love the dynamic between him and Harry so far, anyway, where he's just kind of calm and not easily ruffled. Mm-hmm. And the idea that his faith just flies in the face of everything that Harry stands for.
Yep.
And it, like, low-key gets under his skin and annoys him tremendously. I really like that. I like this. It's going to sound corny, but I like this buddy cop kind of feel. You know?
Yep. There's a reason that trope is so successful.
Yeah, so, yeah. It's early in the book, but I guess unless it goes wildly left, my guess about zombies and or vampires was mm-hmm. wrong. And this is a book about ghosts.
It certainly seems that way right now. yeah, ghosts didn't even like come up, did it, when I asked you about it?
Nope, not at all. And I think it's because I don't think about ghosts and graves for whatever reason. You know,
yeah.
I don't know. Which, you know, surely they go together.
I kind of am on your side of things where I'm just like, they don't stay there. They go to where they used to live and shit.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So okay, Jim Butcher. You got me. Again, maybe.
You got me. Yeah. What are your feelings on ghosts?
We've talked about this in other ones.
In other Dresden Files podcasts?
Not Dresden Files. Other. Like,
okay. So educate our listeners who don't know then.
For you guys that don't know, I believe in ghosts. I had a ghost.
I love the way that you said that. Like it was a bag of chips. Yeah, I had a ghost once. It was pretty good.
And, and I'm pretty sure the ghost saved my life.
Oh, shit.
I had a house with a bunch of girls, and we several of us saw it at different times. And it was in my room primarily, and I had it was a 4-bedroom house split between 8 girls. So it was 2 girls to a room. the girl who's supposed to share my room was so freaked out by the energy in the room and the ghost that she actually left. So I had my own room.
Damn.
So I was like, me and the ghost are like, we're best friends now.
But so, yeah, so the energy really... didn't bother you?
No, I love that room. I still think about that room. I've lived a lot of places, and it's probably my favorite place I've ever spent time.
What a weirdo you are. I love you so much.
It was the third floor back bedroom, and it was the most calming, comforting place I've ever lived. Loved it. Huh. And no one would come up to that floor. Like, I had it.
Oh, enough. Well, there it is.
Pretty much, that's probably really going on.
No more questions. I've got it.
Yeah. I had a girl one time. Were we in the middle of a fight? And she called herself storming up to my room to, like, start some shit in the middle of the night.
Okay.
And she got to my door and turned around and left.
Ooh.
Because she said later she saw it. And it was standing at the door like, can we help you?
Oh, my God.
And she turned around and went right back down the stairs.
Oh, my God. I'm writing a story about this. Writing a story. That's going to happen.
And then there's another story, but I'll tell you that later.
Ooh, shit. This isn't like a Ghostbusters blowjob thing, is it?
God, no. but that's another story.
Yeah, I am somebody who, I believe in ghosts, but I'm not somebody who, like, believes that they're, like, somebody's spirit or soul or anything. I just think they're kind of like photographs. And there's, like, an imprint of energy on the air for some reason. And we just don't know how that works yet.
Gotcha.
But, yeah, I definitely think they are a thing, though. I don't think everybody's just, like, deluded or making it up, which is the only two options that there really are, if you don't believe, I think. But anyway, getting into the story here. So we start off with Harry and the Blue Beetle, and he is careening around Chicago with a very, very calm Michael sitting with him in the car. And they are going to Cook County Hospital. And
this is super intense, high speed as you can get in the Blue Beetle.
Indeed.
And Michael wants to talk about Harry's relationship.
Oh my God, I loved this so much. He's just like, so you love her and you've had sex with her, so when's the wedding? And Harry's like, are you fucking for real right now? I do not have time for this. And he makes Harry say that he loves her, and looks so, like, happy with himself once he gets Harry to say it. But I have to say, like, I wouldn't... That doesn't count. When you have to, like, push somebody to say it that hard.
I love that Michael says, you of all people know how important words are.
Mm, yeah.
I love that so much. Because it's true. Harry knows how important it is to speak something out loud.
Mm-hmm.
Which is probably at the root of his reluctance of saying it.
That's probably true. Yeah, Harry has a little bit of an issue with his emotions and not expressing shit.
He says, I didn't say it, but I got her a card. It's a Hallmark.
Oh, God, I love that. So they get to the hospital, and Michael gets out and gets his fucking sword.
Oh, my God.
And his white cloak with a red cross on the breast.
It's not just a sword. It's a sword that has a name.
Amorakius.
Which, come on. First of all, that's a great name.
Right?
I don't know if where it comes from, or if, you know, if I were to Google it, if it had any other meanings that I wasn't aware of. Obviously, I'm not going to Google it for spoilers. But when someone has a sword that has a name, you know it's real.
Right.
Like, it's a serious situation.
Yeah. Yeah, I enjoy Amorakius. Just, like, hearing, what's-his-face say it. What is the name of the actor? Oh, my God.
James
Marsters. Yeah, his voice with the... He relishes that word every time he says it. Amorakius. And Harry has his duster, and he's taunting Michael's cloak And Michael's like, how about you looking like you're on the set of El Dorado? Maybe don't talk
Finally,
to me.
Finally, someone said it. It needed to be said.
Oh, Harry, like, thinks of it as really badass. Mm. Like, he's like, and it flared out behind me in a very satisfying way. And I'm like, well, satisfying for you, maybe.
Right. Yeah, I really like Michael.
Yeah.
I love the introduction of him. He is just a really perfect foil for Harry.
That's true. Yeah, it's not a foil of just like, oh, he's a bad guy. Or he's a, you know, whatever. It's just a very specific type of good guy.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And they run into the hospital, him with his sword and Harry with his like staff and rod and a bag of powder in his mouth.
I love this whole, we don't pay any attention to us.
Right?
Don't mind us.
I grabbed the arm of the first orderly I saw. He blinked and then gawked at me from the tips of my western boots to the dark hair atop my head. He glanced at my staff and rod rather nervously and at the silver pentacle amulet dangling at my breast and gulped. Then he looked at Michael, tall and broad, his expression utterly serene, at odds with the white cloak and the broadsword at his hip. He took a nervous step back. May I help you? I speared him into place with my most ferocious dark-eyed smile and said between clenched teeth on the leather sack, hi, could you tell us where the nursery is?
And the best thing is that the next page is like they already know where they're going.
Yep.
So the orderly told them.
Yep.
And I'm like, really? You want to send these two guys to where you keep babies?
Yeah, I feel like in 2017 that would not be happening. These guys, they would have been hauled out of there by their asses. And yeah, they go upstairs and the nursery is dark and all of the nurses are asleep. And Harry is like walking. He is noticing how quiet it is.
Mm-hmm.
And he's carrying this candle and it turns blue, the flame, and like kind of the flame like goes down to a pinpoint, which apparently indicates a spiritual presence.
Yeah.
And the reason that they know to come here is because of Bob. We get a little bit of backstory when they're in the car on their right. way there. And there's been shit happening all over town. And Harry and Michael have been working together a ton the past couple of weeks.
Yeah. And we don't know what they don't know. So we don't know yet what's causing all this activity. But it sounds like they've been kept very busy and Bob has been doing a lot of like intel work.
Right.
And so then later on in the nursery scene, we see that Harry knows the backstory of this particular ghost
mm-hmm.
because Bob has already sussed it all out for him.
Yeah. Which is apparently really key to getting a ghost's attention is knowing who they were and addressing them by their name.
Yeah, I like that detail a lot.
Yeah, it's really interesting. Like, yeah. It kind of gives you a different layer to why everybody isn't always around interacting with ghosts.
Mm-hmm.
Like, if you're not magical and you don't know their name, it doesn't really work.
Yeah. And it's interesting when you think about how we're used to seeing it, which is where, at least for me anyway, in a lot of movies and some books, the ghost sort of reacts to the human's presence immediately.
Mm-hmm.
And I like the idea that they are removed enough from us and enough that they might not even notice us if we're mm-hmm. not the point of their, you know, their interest.
Mm-hmm.
And that it takes effort to draw their attention to us.
Yeah, it's like there's a wall that you can mm-hmm. like pound, you can pound on and get their attention, but it takes a minute.
Yeah, yeah.
So he hears a woman singing, hush, little baby, don't say a word. Mama's gonna buy you a mockingbird. And he starts walking towards it and passing the nurses that are asleep. He said The soothing, quiet lullaby continued as I studied the nurses. Enchanted sleep. It was nothing new. They were out, they weren't going anywhere, and there was little sense in wasting time or energy in trying to break the spell's hold on them. The gentle singing droned on, and I found myself reaching for the fallen chair with the intention of setting it upright so that I would have a comfortable place to sit down for a little rest. I froze and had to remind myself that I would be an idiot to sit down beneath the influence of the unearthly song even for a few moments. Subtle magic and strong. Even knowing what to expect, I barely sensed its touch in time.
I really love that. Because yeah. It happened so quickly mm-hmm. that I didn't even realize that the idea to get the chair was a reaction to the magic.
Mm-hmm.
It seems like it's really his thought. You know, I mean, it is his thought. But like as I was reading it, I was like, well, that's weird. Why would you want to sit down?
Mm-hmm.
But then I thought, well, this is going to be a lot of magic, so maybe you're tired.
Right.
And you're just anticipating being tired from the upcoming battle. It didn't even occur to me that it was him reacting to her spell.
Yeah, this is something that comes up here and there in these books, that somebody will... It won't even necessarily be a spell. It'll be just an effect that being around someone has.
Mm-hmm.
And he'll start thinking something and it feels completely like just his thought. And then all of a sudden he snaps out of it and you're like, oh, shit. Which I really like because it gives you the same startled feeling mm-hmm. that he has. Agatha Hagglethorne had not been old when she died. She wore a proper high-necked shirt, as was appropriate to a lady of her station in the 19th century Chicago, and a long, dark, no-nonsense skirt. I could see through her to the little crib behind her, but other than that, she seemed solid, real. Her face was pretty, in a strained, bony sort of way, and she had her right hand folded over the stump at the end of her left wrist. So, he's watching her, and the point here... is that she is doing something to stop these babies from breathing.
Mm-hmm.
And he is supposed to throw this ghost dust, is what he calls it, over her because it pins ghosts in place.
Right. And he even says before he goes in, because Michael's ready to go in with the sword and just have at it.
Mm-hmm.
He's like, no, let me try first. Let me, mm-hmm. you know, let me, maybe I can just dust her and get it all done real quick.
Because he says that she'll feel Michael's sword like a mile away,
mm-hmm.
that she'll sense it and won't be able to run, or he won't be able to get to her before she runs.
Which is interesting because I don't know if I understand why she would sense it.
Yeah, same.
My guess is that it has something to do with Michael's connection to what I'm assuming is God.
Mm-hmm.
And Harry talks about once or twice. Every time Michael crosses himself,
mm-hmm.
he feels
a thrum.
A thrum. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I don't know if it's the same sort of thing, you know,
mm-hmm.
or why she would feel the sword beforehand.
Mm-hmm.
I hope that they explain that a little bit later on.
So he yells her name. And she turns around and she wants to know what he's doing in her nursery. And he's like, listen, bitch, this is not your nursery. You did. Your husband did. Your child's dead. Get out. And
what is that? Remember that vine from fucking the actress Maisie Wilson? What's her name? Maisie Williams?
The one who plays. Yeah, the one who plays Arya.
Right after. Fuck, I don't want to spoil people, but it's late. After she put that vine up after the Red Wedding, she's like, my whole family did.
Oh, right, yes. Right, yeah. That's like really similar, actually. So he is telling her, like, these little ones are not yours to sing or bear away. I steeled myself to throw, began to bring my arm forward. The spirit looked at me with an expression of lost, lonely confusion. This was the hard part about dealing with real, substantial, dangerous ghosts. They were almost human. They appeared to be able to feel emotion, to have some degree of self-awareness. Ghosts aren't alive, not really. They're a footprint in stone, a fossilized skeleton. They're shaped like the original, but they aren't it. But I'm a sucker for a lady in distress. I always have been. It's a weak point in my character.
Oh, Harry.
Right? So
I should not be surprised by this. They've already told me this a couple of times, and they're telling it to me again. But I'm just as irritated.
Yeah.
As I was the first time. And I get that this is just who he is, and maybe I shouldn't expect it to change. But I was like, oh, come on.
Get your act together, son.
Come on. Be a professional.
Yeah, that's the main thing, is be a professional. Like, you know what you have to do. Come on. You got your coworker out there waiting for you.
And every time he comes up against a woman, is this going to be the thing that happens with him? Like, every time? I don't know, guys. I don't know.
So, yeah, he's telling her that she died, and then he starts telling her what happened.
Oh, this was terrible.
Your husband beat you. You were terrified that he would beat your daughter, and when she started crying, you covered her mouth with your hand. And you didn't mean to hurt her, but he was drunk, and you were terrified, and when you looked down, she was gone. And then she says, I remember the axe. The axe, the axe, the axe. The proportions of the ghost's face changed, stretched, became more bony, more slender. I took my axe, my axe, my axe, and gave my Benson 20 whacks. What? What? Okay.
I giggled here.
Right? The spirit grew, expanding, and a ghostly wind rustled through the room, emanating from the ghost and rife with the smell of iron and blood. Oh, crap, I muttered, and gathered myself to make a dash for the girl. So he starts running forward, and the babies start to wake up, and she starts to panic, saying, he'll hear you. And Michael comes in right here, and he starts to, like, fight with her. And Harry's trying to, like, he wants to use the ghost dust, but now that she's raised this wind, the dust won't do anything. So he has to, like, get her to calm down or do something else. So finally, she manifests a fucking axe, which she tries to bring down, and Amorakius parries it.
Yeah.
And Michael's holding her in place and tells Dresden to fucking get on that shit. And he shoves his fist into her weapon arm and shakes loose some of the ghost dust. Upon contact with her immaterial flesh, the ghost dust flared into blazing motes of scarlet light. Agatha screamed and jerked back, but her arm remained in place as firmly as if it had been set in concrete.
That part was like, what?
Right?
Like, she's going, but her arm is still...
Well, she stays with her arm, and then she's like, oh, I gotta go, and just tears herself off of her arm.
Yeah.
What? Yeah,
like, what? Yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm. I'm just gonna stop. Because there are clearly some things at work here that I don't fully understand yet.
It's not something that either of them expected either. Like, they see that happen, and they're like, I mean, I guess. But they basically are going to just take the win because it seems like the babies are going to be okay. And her arm, once it's not attached to her anymore, it turns into ectoplasm and just splashes down on the floor. So they're in the middle of, like, you know, thinking, okay, cool, everything is fine. And then they hear her singing again, and the baby that Harry's, like, looking at stiffens up, and they realize that she's still there, but she's reaching over to the babies from the Never Never. She's not even manifesting in their world, which is apparently something that is not common at all.
Doesn't seem like it. And I mean, they tell us that she's pretty powerful and dangerous, you know, as they're going in to fight her. Mm-hmm. But because I don't really know how this works yet, I was stunned that she was able to reach from the Never Never into where they were and still, you know, have an effect on the babies. Mm-hmm. And I felt a little bit better because they also seem stunned.
Yeah, they definitely do. And Harry does not want to go over to the Never Never. He says, I'm not going on to her home ground naked and offer to go 2 out of 3. And then he says that that the ghost is a bad enough reason to go over. And he also mentions his godmother.
Yeah.
Michael, she'll tear us apart. And even if she doesn't, my godmother will. Michael shook his head, scowling. No, by God, I won't let that happen. And neither will you, Harry Dresden. There's too much good in your heart to let these children die. So finally, Harry's like, fuck, fine. And he rips open a hole into the Never Never and goes on through. And there's a moment right before, you have a good heart, Harry Dresden, Michael said, a fierce grin stretching his mouth. He stepped closer to my side. God will smile on this choice. Yeah, ask him not to Sodom and Gomorrah my apartment and we'll be even. Michael gave me a disappointed glance. I shot him a testy glare. I like that moment where he's like trying to, like, you know, be cool, and Harry's just never going to be cool. Harry cannot be cool.
No, he can't. He's incapable of being cool.
I have no chill whatsoever.
I love, too, that Michael is just, like, you know, heartened by this show of courage, I guess, on Dresden's part. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, I knew you had it in you. And I'm kind of like, but did you, though?
He has to say that. He's the encourager. He's the Mr. Rogers.
So we don't follow them, though.
No, we don't. This makes me crazy.
Yeah.
I really, yeah.
This chapter is pretty much how the other two books started.
Mm-hmm.
So I couldn't be but so mad, but I was a little mad.
Yeah. I had forgotten that this is how this goes. But he jumps back. How far out was it?
I think just to the beginning of this day. Like, this day started out like any other day.
Oh, yeah. I guess you're right. It is just the beginning of the day. And he goes to his office. And he gets a call from Susan. And they have their little back and forth. And things are clearly, like, have gotten more serious between the two of them. And he asks how she is, and she says, well, my boyfriend stood me up last night, but other than that, and he's like, yeah, sorry. Which, like, I understand giving a guy a pass because he fights, you know, the forces of evil and everything, but when he picks up and his first thing he says is not, I'm sorry, when he realizes it's you, that's just bad form.
You know what? You know, I didn't think of it at the time, but you are absolutely right.
Right? Like,
you are absolutely right.
It's also kind of shit that she has to be calling him in the first place. You stand her up, you call her to apologize. You don't wait for her ass to be calling you on some business shit and then, like, you know, belatedly, oh, sorry about that.
I think that's why I gave it a pass, because the conversation starts with them doing their little banter that's like, you know, oh, I'm calling on very official type stuff. And he just was playing along with it immediately.
Mm-hmm.
But upon review... You are absolutely right.
Upon review.
And she should have been the first call he made that morning or that night when he got home.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah.
So she basically pumps him for information. Because she figures that he was out as he was fighting the forces of evil. Mm-hmm. And they have a little, like, cute flirty moment where she's like, well, maybe I'll be so grateful that I'll come by later and say thank you, basically.
Yeah, she's like, I'll put a good word in with your lady friend.
Right.
She also leverages that he stood her up.
That's true.
To get this story about whatever it is he was out fighting the night before, so she can write about it.
Yeah, that's true. She capitalizes on that shit, so she's smart, at least.
He would have told her anyway, though.
Probably. He can't keep shit to himself. So she asks, have you come any closer to working out what's going on with the ghosts? Did you look into the seasonal angle? No, and yes. I still can't figure out why the ghosts seem to be freaking out all at once, and we haven't been able to get to get any of them to hold still long enough for me to get a good look at them. I've got a new recipe to try out tonight. Maybe that will do it. But Bob is sure it isn't a Halloween-y kind of problem. I mean, we didn't have any ghosts last year. No, we had werewolves. Different situation entirely, I said. So, yeah, it's been a year.
Yeah, nice little time stamp there. Mm-hmm. And it's interesting to me that Bob is so sure it's not connected to Halloween.
Mm-hmm.
Which I kind of like, because I always enjoy when a book like this or show or whatever makes it a point to be like, Halloween is not the thing.
Right.
You know? And that's been mentioned in other places and other stories.
Mm-hmm.
So I always like that little detail.
Yeah, it's kind of funny because, like, I want to be like, well, I think he just likes setting things at Halloween. But there's no real reason why he needs to set any of these at Halloween, because there's nothing particularly happening. You know, they're not dealing with there's no pumpkins being thrown around. There's no kids in costumes. There's no candy sales. There's right. no reason for it. But so he's closing the office and this woman comes out of the elevator and he doesn't turn toward her. She says, please, I've got to talk to you. Only you can help me. I sighed without looking at her. She'd said the exact words she needed to in order to kick off my protective streak. But I could still walk away. Lots of people got to thinking that magic could dig them out of their troubles once they realized they couldn't escape. I'll be glad to, ma'am, first thing in the morning. I locked the door and started to turn away. Wait, she said. I felt her step closer to me and she grabbed my hand. A tingling, writhing sensation shot up my wrist and over my elbow. My reaction was immediate and instinctive. I threw up a mental shield against the sensation, jerked my hand clear of her fingers, and took several steps back and away from the young woman. So, that's alarming.
Yeah, so I don't know if we knew that was how he reacted when he runs into someone who practices magic.
No, I don't think so.
I don't think we've seen it, right?
Mm-mm.
But it's a physical sensation, like he can tell as soon as she touches him.
Mm-hmm.
Which I guess makes sense, because if you are a practitioner, you probably have a very different energy, and he could probably pick up on it.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know. It's hard for me to tell if there's anything special about her that causes him to react this way, or if that's just a normal reaction.
Yeah. Yeah, we don't really know enough to make that call yet, I guess. Yeah. She was a slight girl in a black knit dress, black combat boots, and hair dyed to a flat matte black. The lines of her face were soft and sweet, and her skin was pale as chalk around eyes that were sunken, shadowed, and glittering with alley cat wariness. You're a practitioner, I said quietly. And she says, yeah, and they said, she just says they.
Yeah, who are they?
That you would help me.
Mm-hmm.
And he says, well, what is it that you want? And she says, I want your protection. And if I don't have it, I'm not sure I'll live through the night.
So, it's weird because it ends right here. And we know that later on this night, he ends up at Cook County with Michael.
Mm-hmm.
But doesn't seem like they're necessarily connected. Like, you know what I mean?
Yeah, definitely.
Like, I could leap to that conclusion, like, oh, this is how his day started, so clearly this is how he ends up at the hospital.
Mm-hmm.
But, and this is a wild assumption I'm getting ready to make, but it doesn't seem like what they face at the hospital is something that would be threatening her. Like, Agatha's deal seems very specific to infants, right?
Mm-hmm.
Based on her history and all that. I don't know how this ties into this girl. So I'm thinking that whatever's after her is something different than what we just saw at the hospital. Also, I want to know who they are.
The they that said he could help her?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I guess it could be anything as pedestrian as just like the people at McNally's, but I don't think that's right.
McNally's.
I don't think that's what it is.
Yeah, that is a good question because, I mean, he has ads in the yellow pages, so people don't really need to tell her.
Yeah.
Unless you think he's full of shit, I guess.
He does say really quickly when he meets her that he says that he gives lessons to people who need help.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe it could be someone he's given lessons to.
Yeah, I guess that's true.
But I don't know. I don't know.
So yeah, it's definitely frustrating that we have this like really tense jump over into the never never against a psychotic ghost, mm-hmm. and then we get pulled away from it to just talk to this bitch. But I guess it's fine.
Yeah, it seems a little like, why are you in my way right now?
Right? Yeah. Like, I don't think I'd have such hard feelings toward her if it wasn't for this, but right now I'm just like, oh, whatever, you and your problems.
Nobody cares about you and your little problems.
So, I'm just really interested about the rest of this book. I know I've said this, like, practically every time we've recorded, but I've been listening to some of the other audiobooks, and there's just so much I have forgotten. There's just so much packed into all of them that happens that I've just forgotten. And I can't wait. I can't wait for your opinions on stuff. Can't wait to be able to talk to you about it. Well, I guess we did all of our announcements already.
We did.
So, guys, thank you so much for listening and for pledging and being amazing. Rashawn and I are planning a trip to Universal where we are going to hopefully meet up with some listeners. It's going to be in late November. The event is on the Facebook page for the show, facebook.com/unspoiledpod. First day there will be November 28th, and it's going to be focused, of course, on Wizarding World of Harry Potter. And if you are interested in meeting us, you should, you know, see if you can be around down there around that time. We'll be there for about 5 days. So I'm stoked about that because we've had some people coming out of the woodwork to help us out, use like flyer points to get us tickets and stuff, like just amazing amounts of help. And if you're interested in helping beyond, you know, pledging or shopping on Amazon, which you can do, Facebook, not Facebook, I'm over here blurting shit out, unspoiledpodcast.com/Amazon, you can also go to our GoFundMe, which I have pinned to the top of that same Facebook page. We have reached $485. There is not really a time limit on the GoFundMe. I don't have a deadline set up yet. There were a lot of people who are going to be at Universal and really want to make sure that we come, or people who are just, you know, wanting to make sure that we do a live show of some kind and report back. And so they're sending us money to make sure the trip is a success, and it's so appreciated. So,
people are insane.
Yeah, people are maniacs. Maniacs, I tell you. So, yeah, it's gofundme.com/unspoiledhpworld is the, I believe, GoFundMe link. Or you can just find it at the top of the page pinned. So thank you to everybody who has donated so far. And thank you to everybody who has pledged also. Rashawn and I just did the finale episode to season 3 of Sherlock, which I posted last night. So now we're going to start getting into season 4. And that shit is crazy. Crazy. Like, really? Lady, you think season 3 dialed it up when we saw these weird flashes and visions and we're like inside mind palaces and shit? Try again, because I thought that was dialed up to 11, and season 3 takes that and dials it up to like 60. I can't. It is bizarre. It is real weird. I still can't decide if it was brilliant or completely idiotic. I'm totally not
very encouraging.
Yeah, I'm just excited because, like, even if you didn't like it, there is still going to be a lot to talk about. It's going to be fun. It's just, I'm not sure if you'll like it or not. I'm not sure if I like it, you know? So yeah, those of you who have seen the 4th season, you'll know what I'm talking about. And if you want to listen to our thoughts on it, you should definitely become a patron, because that's going to be available to you for $1. And if you're $5 and up, you'll get access to Twin Peaks, which I'm doing right now with Maggie. And we're 2/3 of the way through season 2. And then we're going to be doing the movie. And then we'll be doing the new season, which everybody's flipping their shit over. So I'm excited about catching up and watching new stuff with everybody else. Like a fancy boy. Anyway. Well, thank you for doing this with me this evening, m'lady. I'm glad that you've been enjoying this.
I have. This is off to a great start, so I'm excited to get into it.
Yay! All right, everybody. Thanks so much for listening, and we will see you next week with three more chapters. Toodaloo, motherfuckers.
Bye, guys.
Every time.
I can't help it.
Unspoiled Network Podcast.